It can often be said that there is a fine line between love and hate. Many of us walk that line every day. Friends, family, and coworkers. I can't believe I once liked that guy, shitty, dude. You're a fucking asshole. My personal favorite is I fucking hate that bitch. Then there are those who are always telling you about the human condition or that you need to stop being so hateful. These are the ones who say you need to demonstrate humanity. As for me, I just worry about my condition, and the condition of my family. It's good to have friends, but be realistic, friends you can only trust from here to there. And in my case, not all family or friends had my back. It was a hard lesson I learned the hard way. The good thing about all of this was that I learned who my real family and friends were. My name is Pace Jensen. I am 29 years old, a former soccer player, and an avid runner. I'm married to Amy. She's a hot little mommy with the appropriate attitude, but the best part of my life is that I'm a father of three little boys. At the time of our collapse, Amy and I had been married for about 7 years. The reason we had children so quickly and often was because I couldn't get enough of my wife. I lived and breathed Amy. That's where my downfall began, I believe. We made our vows the day after we graduated from college. We both graduated from UMass. Amy majored in secondary education and I majored in management information systems. Amy got a job at one of the elite private schools in Dallas, and I worked at Empire Funding. We had a pretty good start in life. There were ups and downs during our marriage as there are in most marriages, but nothing serious. I think our first fight occurred when I wanted to buy a 1968 Shelby Cobra GT500. It was a two-door fastback with a 302-inch 3.49-liter V8 engine GT350. To top it off, it was candy apple red with two white stripes in the middle. Unlike some people I know, I could afford a $100,000 car, but I love classic cars. Anyway, like I said, Amy and I had a great life. We lived pretty close to my family, and I thought that was a good thing. My mom and dad were in there and I also had a younger brother named Rob. Rob was 17 years old and went to the same high school that Amy taught at. In fact, she taught his class as well. I think Rob was an ops kid because he was 12 years younger than me. Rob and I were as close as you can be to a little brother who is 12 years younger than you. When anything happened or when Rob needed something, I was expected to make the sacrifice. That's how my family lived. That was our motto. You need to have courage and deal with it. Be a hero, son. Just give it to your little brother, and you'll be a better person in the long run. My dad repeated this so and that it got to the point where I just let it pass my ears. Another good thing in my life was my best friend, Jeffrey Parks. He was the kind of brother I wished I had. We had been best friends since third grade. And if anyone knew how I felt, it was him. Jeff was an attorney, and I expected him to have my back in all legal matters. Anyway, last Monday, when I got home, Amy told me that she had taken the boys to her sister's house. It was four houses away. When she told me that, I thought we'd be alone, if you know what I mean, but she said she had something she wanted to tell me. I didn't think life could get any better, but then Amy told me she was pregnant. I wanted to know when the baby was due so we could start buying things before the baby was born. I guess I was as happy as a person can be. Heck, I was just hoping it would be a little girl so I could spoil her to death. But for some reason, Amy was a little out of it, and she had this detached look on her face. I asked her what was wrong. Pace. It's not your baby. Amy said it so quietly. I couldn't hear. What's going on, honey? Why are you so depressed? Pace. I love you, but I'm not having any more of your babies. Amy said. I was a little confused and asked her why. Amy, you always said you wanted a big family. So why such a sudden change? Jesus, this isn't going to be easy. Then Amy started going around and around as if whatever she was about to say was going to change her life. "Amy, I love you no matter what. So just tell me how you feel right now. Just say it." Then she stopped, pulled out her phone, hit speed dial. "Could you come over here, please?" Whoever she was talking to, it sounded like they knew more about this than I did. "Amy, who was that? And what the hell is going on?" Amy said, "Just keep up the pace, I need help getting my words to you. I don't want to mess up what I have to say." I asked her who was coming and what it was that she just couldn't tell me without help. Heck, if you can't tell your husband, who the hell else could you tell? All sorts of thoughts ran through my head. None of them good, but what came next shocked me. 2 minutes later, the doorbell rang. Amy answered the door, and when she came back, she was followed by my mom, my dad, and my 17-year-old brother, Rob. "Okay, Amy. What the hell is going on? Shit. How can I say this without hurting you?" Rob just stepped in. "Look, Pace. Amy is in love with me. That's what she wants to say. Mom and Dad are here to support us." Rob said, "Look, bro, shit happens. We didn't want to fall in love, but we did. The baby she's carrying is mine, and we need you to go along with that. Amy and I are going to be a family whether you like it or not." I started laughing like it was some kind joke. Right? It was meant to be. "Look, Amy, so what are you trying to tell me?" No one laughed. I looked back at Amy. She was looking at her feet. "Amy, please look at me and tell me that's not true. Tell me you're not such a fucking idiot." My father said, "Son, I know it's hard, but what's done is done. I know you're hurting right now, but Rob is your brother. And so we have to find a way to deal with this. We know it takes a lot, but sacrifices have to be made." I asked my mom if she was involved in this. She said, "Son, I love both my boys. I don't want this to tear our family apart. You have to find a way to live with it. We're all family. You have to be the hero in this. You have to find it in your heart to not be angry and to do the right thing." I couldn't believe they were asking me to just sacrifice my life for a snotty little jerk because I was older. At that moment, I mean, that exact moment, I started to hate them all. I mean, seriously and with passion. The fine line between love and hate had been breached. The question is, how much can I a man hate my family? The very family that betrayed me on every side, my wife, my brother, and what parent would agree to this travesty? How could I have known it would only get worse? I couldn't take it anymore. I turned and walked out with Amy and my mom in tow. Rob pulled Amy away from me. I went through four houses to pick up my kids. At her sister's house, I was met by a sheriff's deputy. For a moment, I thought Amy's sister, Rachel, was involved, but she looked as shocked as I was. The deputy sheriff told me that I was forbidden to see my children until the court made a custody decision. I looked around and felt the hatred growing more and more with each passing second. I asked the sheriff if I could go back to my own home. He asked whose name was on the mortgage. I said mine and mine alone. Since there was no order prohibiting me from being home, I turned around to go home. As I passed my father, he grabbed my hand. "Pace, listen, son, please don't do anything that you will regret later." My father said, "We all need to sit down and discuss this like adults." I looked at him and told him to never call me a fucking son again. "No. Get your fucking hand off me, or you'll regret it for the rest of your life. Now leave me alone, all you backstabbing bitches." I looked at Amy and told her, "If I were you, I'd hire a good lawyer. Because trust me, you're going to need it. Enjoy the kids while you can. Now get the hell out of here, whore, and take these assholes with you." Before I could take another step, Rob shot at me. He hit me on the right side of my face. Before I could bounce away, my dad grabbed me and Rob hit me again. I was lucky Rob hit like a bitch, or I would have been hurt. The sheriff jumped off the porch, ran up and pounced on Rob. I broke free of my father's grip and punched him in the mouth with my fist. He fell to the ground and the look on his face was complete shock. He never would have believed that Pace, a sensible kid, would get so angry. When the fight was over, Rob and his father were arrested for assault, but I had no idea that the best was yet to come. A couple days later, I got a call from the assistant district attorney asking me to testify. In doing so, I just casually mentioned that it all started when my 29-year-old wife of 7 years was pregnant by my 17-year-old brother. I also said that the brother went to 12th grade at the same school that Amy taught at. They seemed to show some interest in this information. 2 days later, I went to meet with the only person I could rely on, Jeffrey Parks, an attorney. I arrived at his office in high spirits. It turned out to be another trip in treachery down the Pace Jensen freeway. While waiting for him to finish, he came out with his new client. Amy looked over, saw me, and smirked. I looked at Jeff and said, "Better, Jeff. You'd better do it with me." Jeffrey Parks turned and walked away. That's how it was arranged so quickly. Jeff was their man. He knew how I would react and cut me short. I never thought she'd do something like that. I'll always wonder why he decided to follow her, but then you know what? Who cares about his reasons? Because once he said yes, he no longer existed for me. To hell with them. I had to laugh again, but there was a difference. It was just another reason to keep crossing the line. I was becoming a different person. Hate can do that to you. I turned to a different kind of lawyer, Stevie Crust. Stevie was known as an ulcer. His motto was, "If you have money, go for it." He was about to close his office when I found him. I asked him if he wanted to get involved in a case that would soon receive Nash publicity. He saw the dollar signs, unlocked his door, and we walked in. I wrote him a check for $10,000. I told him that sooner or later he would have to bail me out. He told me he couldn't participate in anything illegal. I told him my plans. He laughed so hard he spit out his gum. I went home. When I got there was a sheriff's deputy sitting in the driveway. He got out of his car and asked who I was. I showed him my ID. He gave me an envelope and said, "You have been served." I walked in and threw the papers in the trash can. I didn't even look at them. Then I made some calls, had a snack, and went to bed. Tomorrow would be a new day. After a good night's sleep, I brushed my teeth, rinsed my mouth, and combed my hair. After all, I need to look my best. As soon as I walk out the door to grab the paper, bam! They pounce on me. "Mr. Jensen, is it true that your wife is a teacher and pregnant by your underage brother?" one reporter asked. Then another asked what school she teaches at. Another asked why she was still out. I said, "I don't know who should be doing this." From that point on, life became hell for everyone involved in this sad case. Reporters were posted outside Amy's school, my parents' house, Jeff's office, and Amy's sister's house. Jeff liked publicity, but not like this. When Amy and my former parents first approached Jeff, he was under the impression that Rob was at least 18, not 17. The next thing pissed Jeff off even more. It was when his office was picketed by a group of family rights activists. One of the protesters doused him with cow urine. The next morning I appeared on the Nancy Grace show. She called Amy anything but a child of God. If any of you watch the Nancy Grace TV show, you know that once she gets the story, she is like a dog with a bone. From the first moment to the end of the story, Nancy's reporting was all about Amy and her merry band of misfits. "Hi, everyone. A child molester is walking free on our streets and pregnant with an impressionable young man. And where's the DA?" Nancy shouted. I taped the show. I looked pretty dapper. I think so myself, but the camera does add 10 pounds. 2 days later, Amy was arrested for sex with a minor, breach of public trust, and rape. Rob was removed from his parents' custody and sent to juvie. They eventually learned that he had to stay there until he turned 18. A month later, I was sitting in a courtroom across from Amy and my former family. She was represented by an asshole who used to be my friend. The only person I felt sorry for was my mom. She just sat there looking sad. It was heartbreaking, but such is life. Amy and Mrs. Jensen had called me hundreds of times over the past month, asking if I would sit down and talk to them. Before things went too far, I asked Amy one question. Did you sit down and talk to me before you slept with my brother? She didn't answer. So there was no point in talking. After Amy was arrested, my children were returned to me. At a quick custody hearing, the judge awarded me full custody, child support, and the house, which was already in my name. As the criminal trial approached, I was scheduled to testify. I wanted to make sure this slutty wench did a long time in jail, but that was not to be. Amy never went to trial. She took a plea bargain and got 3.5 years. In her statement at sentencing, she apologized to me. I almost felt sorry for her. Her life was ruined. Her teaching career was over, and for better or worse, she would have to register as a sex offender for the rest of her life. 4 years have passed since then. I took the kids and moved 2,000 miles away. Now that our family consisted of 7 people, my 3 sons and Amy's 2 little daughters, we were a smaller version of the Brady family. I know. I know. The BTB crowd is going to call me a wuss. And you know what? They'd be dead wrong. You think I'm stupid enough to stay with any whore who will sleep with my former little brother? Hell no. My wife's name is spelled Amy. I met her 4 months after we moved in. Amy is a motorcycle cop, and the day she wrote me a ticket changed my life. When she got back to her motorcycle, all it took was one look at her ass, and I knew she was going to be my next wife. I had to beg a little, but once I got her into bed, it was the greatest day of my life. Did I mention she has her own handcuffs? I love her to death, but it took her a long time to overcome my distrust. Amy has faced a lot of shit over the years, and she's been through just as much. She's just like me. She doesn't trust shit. She tests me the same way I test her, and it works for us. But most of all, I like the hell out of her in bed.